It's that time of the year again when Navigraph releases the annual flight simulation community survey. And what a year it has been. There are three new flight simulators released: Lockheed Martin Prepar3D version 5 in April, Microsoft Flight Simulator 2020 in August, and Laminar Research X-Plane 1150 in September. How have they been received so far? Which flight simulator platform is the most popular? Is virtual reality taken off yet? And how has spending and usage changed since the last year? How about COVID-19? How has the pandemic affected the flight simulation community? My name is Magnus, I'm the CEO of Navigraph. Come along and I'll show you some of the highlights in the results. Here at Navigraph, we have four people working on this survey. In addition to myself, our community manager, Andy, and our customer service coordinator, Malin, has been busy designing the questionnaire and later crunching and plotting the data that you have provided us with. Steven, our co-founder and CTO, helped with setting up the database and did some data juggling, like converting spending graphs to US dollars. He also set up the collaborative tools that we needed in these times of Corona. I say this because I want to stress that this is a teamwork. On the topic of teamwork, let me say this. Although this is the fifth year that we're doing some sort of survey, it's actually the third consecutive year that we're teaming up with partners to help design the questions. Yes, we invite add-on developers, interest organizations, media outlets, and companies who are active in the flight simulation domain. And this year, there were 30 of us. Together, we discuss which questions to include in the survey and which overall themes that are especially interesting this year. When the questions are ready, the partners help in distributing the survey link to users, members, customers, and readers. I have to stress, the level of participation is completely voluntary, and we appreciate that some partners are able to contribute more or less and in different ways than others. We're totally flexible and just super grateful for all the help that we get. If you want to get involved as a partner for next year, reach out to us already now on survey@navigraph.com. Okay, now look at this. In 2018, we had 15,000 respondents. Last year, we had 17,800 respondents, and already then we were completely bananas. This year, an amazing 23,500 respondents provided us with data that we now give back to you in the shape of this video, and a free survey report of 120 pages, which you can download from the Navigraph blog, among other places. This year, we're also doing something really special to amplify the collaborative nature of this survey. We're making all of the data that we collected available for free for anyone that wants to do analysis of their own. Again, just go to the Navigraph blog and download the data from there. Just make sure that you share any findings with the community under the hashtag FlightSimSurveyAnalysis. More on that later. Let's get on with the survey. The survey is big. With 119 questions, it's the most comprehensive one of its kind in the world. It covers demographics, relation to aviation, simulator habits for combat sims, mobile sims, air traffic control, and of course regular sims. We also look at consumption habits, the community, the technical aspects of the flight simulator platform. Virtual reality has a separate section, and so does add-on training and media. I'm going to flick through a few diagrams here as I talk about the results. If I'm going too fast or if you want to have a closer look, you can either pause the video or better yet, go to the Navigraph blog and look at the complete report. It has lots more diagrams and also some comparisons of trends of previous years. If you have any questions or comments, just leave them here in the comments field and we will try to answer them best we can. Let's start with some of the demographics. Age. Something that strikes me is that flight simulation is interesting for all ages. The distribution is pretty even from 15 to 75. However, there's a curious peak at 20. This peak has been there over the last 2 years as well. In terms of gender, flight simulation continues to be a male-dominated activity. This result is also consistent with the last 2 years. The majority of the survey respondents come from either United States, followed by the United Kingdom, Germany, Canada, or Australia. The curious part here is that these countries have been in the top five for the last 3 years in this order. On the topic of relation to aviation, here are some of the results you'll find. 19.3% of the respondents work somewhere in the aviation domain. 4.7% are airline pilots. This is comparable to last year. 25.8% of the respondents have a pilot license. 9% have a PPL. In last year's survey, 30% of the respondents held a pilot license. 7.8% of the respondents are currently enrolled in flight school. And among the ones that are not already enrolled, 25.7% are considering taking real-world flight lessons in the next year. Now, when it comes to simulation habits, it's a pretty mixed bag of general aviation and narrow and wide body airliners. This can also be seen in the question about flight rules, where VFR and IFR seems to be equally popular. It's about half-half. In this question, we have also included another option, casually flying without rules, to get some insight into simmers who might not be flying strictly according to the book at all times, but rather just want to entertain themselves. Lots of numbers and figures in this survey. You can find many more exciting diagrams in the survey report. How many times per week do you fly your simulator? How many hours do you use the simulator during a typical session? All that good stuff that you expect from a decent survey. As you know, we also want the survey to be a document of the times we live in. What are the current events of this year? Well, three new simulators have been released, and we're coming to that. But first, a word on the ongoing pandemic. Yes, we had to include this topic in the survey. It would be strange not to. You see, we discussed at great length whether to include any questions relating to COVID-19 because we didn't want to be perceived as insensitive or prying in any way. We wanted to ask questions that provide real insights to the community, not just curiously asking about everyone's misery. So this is what we did. We asked quite directly if respondents' employment situation has changed during the past year as a consequence of COVID-19, thinking that a change in time or income might have an effect on both future usage and consumption. 13.9% report having changes in employment situation due to COVID-19. 4.8% prefer not to say. There was also another instance where COVID-19 came up, but indirectly. We asked if any of you had returned to flight simulation this year. It was about 50-50, and among the 50.6% that said yes, we asked if any of the three simulators were the reason for your comeback. If you're interested in those answers, you can see the question for yourself in the survey. But what we found most interesting about this question is that a fifth of you stated some other reason for comeback. 8% of those 22.7% that provided a free text answer said that the reason for returning to flight simulation this year was somehow related to Corona or COVID-19. There's also a third question in the survey, where we ask respondents to estimate if they are spending more or less time on flight simulation now because of COVID-19. 45% say that they spend an equal amount of time. 43% say that they spend more time. Only 5.2% say that they spend less time as a result of Corona. Interestingly, we couldn't verify an increase in usage with other diagrams, so perhaps it just feels like you're spending more time on flight simulation, but in reality, you're not. Okay, over to something lighter. A few days ago, Microsoft released virtual reality support for their flight simulator. Virtual reality has always been a part of the community survey, and this year is no exception. In fact, we have increased the number of questions this year. What brands of HMDs you guys are using, IPD awareness, typical VR session length, preferred controls, preferred views, all that good stuff. We can report that VR headset ownership is at a steady 12% for the last 2 years, but it will be interesting to track this question for the next year, as we believe that the Microsoft Flight Simulator will convince many users to give it a try. In this year's survey, we're also doing a deep dive into graphics cards and whether people know how to keep their drivers up to date. This was originally a set of questions intended to explore the Vulkan and metal support for X-Plane 1150, but it now also has some bearing on how performant computers are when it comes to supporting virtual reality. Another area where we think Microsoft Flight Simulator will have a noticeable effect is on the composition of pilots in the flight simulation community. And here's what I mean. Over the last years, we have measured how many users that own a gaming console. It's been pretty steady at 16%. However, now that Microsoft will be releasing its flight simulator on Xbox next summer, we think that we will be seeing a lot more casual pilots, also known as gamers, take an interest in aviation. We have included a few questions in the survey on this topic too. For instance, we're asking why people fly. 55.3% say it's for curiosity or interest in aviation, and 19.6% say it's for casual gaming or entertainment. We think that this mix will change, and if it does, What will this mean for the high fidelity controls and the realism of actually piloting an aircraft? Currently, 67.8% would like to connect joke and pedals to the console, and 58.4% would engage in the same activities on the console as they would on a desktop computer. However, will control and interfaces support that, or will we see a simulator become more gamified? And if we do, would that be a bad thing? On the topic of gamification, 40% seems to agree that it would be a good thing to add badges or some sort of score to indicate your performance. Actually, 52.4% play other computer games aside from flight simulation. Okay, mostly truck and train simulators, but also first-person shooters, Grand Theft Auto, Call of Duty, and Minecraft. Anyhow, we think that the console will open up a much larger audience and will most likely result in a nice influx of new users to the flight simulation community. More pilots, more developers, more customers, and more friends. All right, what do you say? Enough of the chit-chat and cut straight to the diagram that probably has the majority of you by the edge of your seat right now. Am I right? Here it is, the diagram of the most popular flight simulation software in the community according to the survey respondents. The new Microsoft Flight Simulator 2020 racks up 61%, followed by Laminar Research X-Plane 1150 in second place with 44%. In third place, we find Lockheed Martin Prepar3D, but not version 5, but its predecessor, version 4. Actually, both DCS World and Microsoft FSX come before Prepar3D version 5 in this diagram. We also did another type of analysis on the same data, where we counted all respondents who had stated that they had ever flown a particular simulator and grouped the responses according to all versions of Prepar3D, all versions of X-Plane, and previous versions of Microsoft Flight Simulator. Slicing the data in this way still left Microsoft Flight Simulator 2020 at the top with 60.4% and Laminar Research X-Plane in second place with 50.6%. Lockheed Martin Prepar3D is still in the third place, but now with 44.8%. All previous versions of Microsoft Flight Simulators currently account for 38.1%. We also asked a few questions to try to figure out the movement of users between simulator platforms. First, we asked if you had switched your primary flight simulation platform during this year. 47.8% said yes, they have switched, and the majority have switched to FS 2020. The respondents who claimed to have switched to FS 2020 during the year came from all other platforms. The distribution was almost a third from each platform. The users who had switched from Prepar3D version 5, almost all of them came from previous versions of Prepar3D. The users who had switched from X-Plane mainly came from earlier versions of Microsoft Flight Simulator FSX and FS9. There are a few things to take into consideration when trying to interpret these results. For instance, for those of you who thought that FS 2020 would be more popular and win by a landslide, it may be that the respondents have indeed purchased a new simulator, but still haven't made it into their primary flight simulator yet. Also consider that we have not measured a full year yet. Prepar3D was launched in April, FS 2020 in August, and X-Plane in September. As usual, we need to follow up on this question over the next year to track the changes. Actually, now in hindsight, we realize that we forgot to ask you guys something about the three new simulators. Which features do you like the most? Which features do you like the least? And are there any features that you miss altogether? Please put your comments in the comments field below and don't forget to mention which simulator you're using. Remember last year when we asked you guys whether you were holding back in your spending in anticipation of the new Microsoft Flight Simulator? Actually, 43% of you said you did. Here's a graph of the software spending in blue and the hardware spending in red over the last 2 years. It's a cumulative graph, so it takes a little while to decipher, but in essence, it says that this year we have spent more on hardware, and this year, however, we are not so keen on spending on software. That's it, folks. If you want to dig deeper, go find a report on blog.navigraph.com. This is also where you'll find the raw data if you want to do some of your own analysis. We haven't had time to do any correlation studies, but that would certainly be interesting. Share your findings under the hashtag FlightSimSurveyAnalysis and we will make sure to repost on our social media accounts so that everyone sees your findings. We will be back next year with another survey. Is there something you think we should cover in more detail? Did we miss something? Let us know in the comments. If you want to be a partner in next year's survey, you can get in touch with us already now at survey@navigraph.com. I just want to close by saying thank you to all of the respondents who took the time to participate in the survey. I also want to thank the partners for suggesting questions and topics to us and for circulating the survey. Lastly, I want to give the team here at Navigraph a good pat on the back for all their hard work. That's all for now. Stay safe and see you soon.